go into the house of the Lord. Let us stand for our opening selection. May Johnny Jones Choir.
Our scripture for the morning comes from Psalm 34, starting at verse 1. I will extol the Lord at all times. The King James Version says, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise will always be on my lips. My soul will boast in the Lord. Let the afflicted hear and rejoice. Glorify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord, and he answered me. He delivered me from all my fears. Those who look to him are radiant, their faces are never covered with shame. This poor man called, and the Lord heard him. He saved him out of his troubles. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him, and he delivers all of them. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man that takes refuge in him. May the Lord add a blessing to his already blessed word. May we find peace and comfort in knowing that God's word does not change. Let us humble our hearts for a moment of prayer. God, this morning we come to say thank you. Thank you for yet another new day here in your kingdom, God. God, we thank you today for divine health and healing in our bodies. We thank you today, Father God, for supplying our needs according to your riches and glory through Christ Jesus. God, we thank you today for everything that you continue to do for us. And we will bless you at all times, and your praise shall continually be in our mouths. God, I thank you today that you've given all of us the opportunity to draw just a little closer to you, God. God, in these trying times that we're living in, we need you even the more. It's a time in our lives, Father God, when we can follow the two greatest commandments that Jesus gave. Loving you with all our mind, body, and soul. And loving our neighbor as ourselves. Father God, we thank you that you've given us an opportunity to be that person that you called us to be. And we put you first place in our lives, Father God, because you say it in Matthew 6:33, seek ye first the kingdom of heaven and its righteousness, and all these things will be added. God, we realize that every good and perfect gift comes from you. And we thank you that, God, you've seen what we need and you supplied what we need. God, thank you.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you for a roof over our head, God. Thank you for clothes. Thank you for just loving friends. And God, I thank you that in this heat that we're going through, that we are able to be in a building that's cool. God, but there's so many people around the world that are suffering right now. Touch them right now, God, where they are in their struggles. And God, you know their struggles. So today, God, we pray for those that are weak. We pray for those that are weak, Father God, in the midst of all that's going on around us. We pray for our family members and friends. We pray for those that are sick and shut in. We pray for all those soldiers around the world, Father God, that are sitting out in the sweltering heat, protecting this nation. God, we say thank you.
Thank you.
God, bless all the EMS and all the police officers and all the public servants. God, allow them, Father God, to realize that they can't do anything without you. And I thank you today, God, and just for blessing us. Bless your manservant today as he breaks the bread of life. Speak through him, Father God, today with boldness and clarity, proclaiming the good news of Jesus Christ, our coming King. First, giving you glory, giving you honor, giving you praise, because you and you alone are worthy of all the glory and praise. Let the church say amen and amen again for the Holy Spirit. Church collector, but before we have an announcement, at the funeral at high school the other day for Floyd Miles Jr., I had been sitting there for about 2.5 hours and got ready to come out, and I had to get out. But when I got to the top, I was looking for the restroom. I said, I got to find the restroom. So I saw a little Chase standing. I said, Chase, where's the men's room? He said, there it is right there. So I said that to say, he was right on time. And I'm in a crowd of people looking for him. But I say that to say that our young folk can really be a blessing to us if we allow them to. Because God wants them to be a blessing, but God wants them to learn. Somebody have asked me that over the years. On another note, our mobile food pantry, instead of being July 3rd to July the 4th, it's going to be Wednesday, July the 3rd at 8:30 in that order. So I called Daniel yesterday to put it on the bulletin, but I figured since I was up here, I'd go ahead and announce that. So you can pass that word on. I'm going to try to put a sign up down at the store there at Dollar General so people will know, because they're going to be here early because of the heat. 8:30. July the 3rd. So just pass that on. So we want to be able to get in here and get out. Also, possibly next Sunday, We're going to have to strip it some. We have some ground chicken in the freezer in the back. We're going to need to distribute some of that to get rid of it, because we're going, when that next batch comes in, we'll have room to keep that. So if you need some ground chicken next Sunday, just feel free to talk to whoever's going to be passing it out and to grab some. It's enough for everybody. So God bless you guys and have a blessed week. Daniel, it's your show now.
I hope everyone had a great week. Just a few announcements. June 27th will be our church business meeting at 6 p.m. June 30th will be Scholarship Sunday, as well as Education Appreciation Sunday. So we're inviting all educators to come and fellowship. July the 1st through July the 6th, there will be no practices or any meetings. And Vacation Bible School will be held on July 8th through the 10th. Please email all church announcements to the email address listed in your bulletin by Thursday. Ruthville Charles City High School's Alumni Association, members needed. Attendees of Ruthville and Charles City High School, spouses and friends are eligible for membership. Interested in joining us, submit your application and $25 or annual dues. If anyone is interested, I do have some applications. Those are all of our announcements, and I hope everyone has a great week.
church say amen again? God is good and all the time. Amen. We're so thankful today to be able to be here in the house of the Lord one more time. Amen. I don't take this for granted, because during COVID, we would be outside. Amen. And we would have had church at 9 o'clock or probably on the day, probably 8. Amen. And you'll be sitting out there with your, well, some of you will be sitting out there in your cars, and we will be having a great time. However, we are so thankful that on today we can be in the household of faith. Amen. Don't take it for granted. Don't take it for granted. God is good. Now, my brothers and sisters, I want you to be aware of the fact that there's so many things that are being thrown at us so far as voting is concerned, that you don't know what to believe or even what you're seeing on television. Because with AI, you know, they can alter stuff. And, you know, they can take my face and put it on a big muscular body and have me looking like, you know, I'm Mike Tyson or Arnold Schwarzenegger or some, you know, they could do all kinds of things. And guess what? They are doing all kinds of things. Things to trick you, things to trick us, things to make us just discouraged so that we can stay home. Also, there's things that are happening over in Israel, of course. There's a lot of people upset about that. However, I would say, no matter what you are upset about, go register and then show up and vote. Amen. Because we're talking about not only just we're talking about our way of life. And so, please, ma'am, please, sir, our forefathers, our foremothers, they risked everything, everything, to get the right to vote. And let's not sit home and act as if it's nothing. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Well, we certainly thank God for all that has taken place. Certainly, on last Sunday, we had a magnificent speaker, and we're thankful to God for him, and we ask that you will continue to pray for him and uplift him as he goes his way. We also are thankful for our rapper that came. It was such a great and a refreshing change, because usually when you talk about rap, you're talking about some people running around speaking filthy language and so on and so forth, calling our ladies out of their names and talking about how they're going to shoot people and kill people and all this type of nonsense. And yet last Sunday we saw someone that came with a testimony. And he talked and spoke about the love of God and what God had done for him in his life. And so we thank God for him. It's not just the element, it's what you do with the element. It's not rap. Rap itself isn't bad, it's what you do with rap that's bad. As we found out about Facebook and all these other modalities, people were hesitant with that. It's not Facebook. It's what you do with Facebook. You can use it for the good or you can use it for evil. And so we thank God we thank God for the service on last Sunday. Amen. We are looking forward to the Education and Scholarship Sunday on next Sunday. We have someone that came through St. John Baptist Church that's coming back to speak. Amen. And we are so thankful to have him. He's on his way to getting his PhD. And he felt that it would be, he accepted the time to come back and be with us. And we thank God for him. His name slipped me. Dallas Wallace III. Amen. And so we'll be looking forward to seeing him on next Sunday. Amen. Amen. Out of the scripture, the 18th verse, begin with the 18th verse in second chapter of Revelation. To the angel of the church in Thyatira, these are the words of the Son of God, whose eyes are like blazing fire, whose feet are like burnished bronze. I know your deeds, your love and faith, your service and perseverance, and that you are now doing more than you did at first. Nevertheless, I have this against you. You tolerate that woman Jezebel, who calls herself a prophet. By her teaching, she misleads my servants into sexual immorality and the eating of food sacrificed to idols. I have given her time to repent of her immorality, but she is unwilling. So I will cast her on a bed of suffering, and I will make those who commit adultery with her suffer intensely, unless they repent of her ways. I will strike her children dead, then all the churches will know that I am he who searches hearts and minds, and I will repay each of you according to your deeds. Now I say to the rest of you in Thyatira, to you who do not hold to her teaching and have not learned Satan's so-called deep secrets, I will not impose any other burden on you except to hold on to what you have until I come. To the one who is victorious and does my will to the end, I will give authority over the nations. That one will rule them with an iron scepter and will dash them to pieces like potter. Just as I have received authority from my Father, I will also give that one the morning star. Whoever has ears, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Amen. Ain't nothing like the real thing. Ain't nothing like the real thing. This was a song that came out in 1968, probably before many of you were born. But the song was with Marvin Gaye and Tammy Terrell. And Mrs. Terrell was singing, and she said, I've got your picture hanging on the wall, but it can't see or come to me when I call your name. I realize it's just a picture in a frame. And I read your letters when you're not near, but they don't move me. They don't groove me like when I hear your sweet voice whispering in my ear. Ain't nothing. Nothing like the real thing. Sister Terrell is trying to communicate to Brother Gaye, but Brother Marvin Gaye, get that right, that there's nothing like the real thing. The real thing. It's just a picture on the wall. It can't move her. It can't touch her. It cannot come to her. It's nothing at all like the real thing. Have you ever had something that you thought was real and it turned out to be fake? Have you ever thought that something was the real thing, but it turned out to be a fake thing? I remember just something just as simple as a hamburger. The meat that we used to get for hamburgers, my stepfather went out and they killed and butchered cow, and some of you have had cows butchered. Some of you knew the people that butchered the cows. Some of you knew the cows. Mr. Haskins, my stepfather didn't like hamburgers, so he would give it all to Grandma, and Grandma would just take it, and she would put things in it. She would put onions in it, and she would fix it. And when you got a hamburger from Grandma, it was thick. It had Worcestershire sauce, onions, and it meant something. And, you know, and we didn't have hamburger bread. It was just regular bread. But she put that thing together, and when you got it, you would just eat it. You had to hold it with both hands, and you would eat it. And it was so good, so tasty. It wasn't USDA approved, but it was good. And so it was so good that you wanted more. But you know, when you get real food, you can't eat but so much of it. And so one burger would make it for me. That would do me. One big thick burger would make it for me. But then you look on television and you see Arby's, the meat people. And you see that you can go to Burger King to have it your way, and McDonald's. And all of these burgers feel the television screen. They're so large. Takes two hands to handle a Whopper. And then when you go and order, and you look at this little burger, and then you say, well, okay, maybe it tastes good. And you bite into it. And you know, they've added something to that meat. It's something else to that meat. It's not just hamburger. It's something else. And sometimes it almost tastes like cardboard. You bite into it. You thought you had the real thing. But you ended up with a fake. Ain't nothing like the real thing. Baby. Jesus is trying to tell this church, not trying, but telling this church, the church of Thyatira, that there's nothing like the real thing. He wants them to go back to the gospel, the right gospel, the correct gospel. The gospel that they started with, not the fake gospel. The gospel where it's a prosperity gospel, or a gospel that's name it, claim it. A gospel where it's Reverend Ike. A gospel where it's white nationalism. He wants them to go back to the real deal, the real thing. Now, a lot of you are probably asking, well, what's the real thing? What's the real gospel? And I'm going to tell you what the real gospel is. It came through Peter, but it went to Paul, and Paul speaks about the real gospel. He says so in 1 Corinthians 15, chapter, beginning with the third verse. He says, for what I received, I pass on to you as of first importance. What happened? Paul was saved. He met Jesus on the Damascus Road. And for 3 years, he was off in Arabia, and Jesus was teaching him. He came back preaching, and then he went up to Jerusalem to make sure that what he had received from the Lord was the same thing Peter was telling the people. And they found out that it was the same thing. This saying started about 2 weeks after Jesus was raised. And it was a saying that was put like this so that people who couldn't read could pick it up and take it with them no matter where they went. And the saying was that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas. And they go on and say how many people that he appeared to. But that is the gospel, that Jesus died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures. Jesus died. Jesus was buried. Jesus was raised. That is the scriptures. Now, if you believe in that, then you are saved. Paul further says in Romans, the word is near you. It is in your mouth and in your heart. That is the message concerning faith that we proclaim. If you declare or confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. That's the gospel. The gospel is that Jesus died, Jesus was buried, and Jesus was raised. If you believe that, if you believe in your heart and confess with your mouth that he is Lord, you shall be saved. This is the gospel. The question comes out, who is on the Lord's side? And the people at Thyatira said, we are. Now, I don't know about how the Southern Baptist is going to handle this, but Paul and Silas was preaching in a place called Philippi. They were there preaching. They went to the lake to get some water, and there was a woman called Lydia. Lydia was a businesswoman, and she was in town selling her wares. She dealt with purple. She was very successful in what she was doing. Paul and Silas began preaching to her and the others. And guess what? They believed that Jesus died. They believed that Jesus was buried. They believe that Jesus was raised, and Paul and Silas baptized them right there that day in the lake. Now, this lady was a business lady from Thyatira, and she told Paul, this is in Acts, over in the Acts chapters. But she told Paul and Silas, once you get through, or if I have found favor in your sight, please come and stay at our house. Now, you know, Paul and Silas, they went, they got put in jail, they were thrown in prison, they were preaching, they were singing, and the jail, the jail, whole jail collapses, the earthquake, and they had a whole lot of things that they were doing, but they ended up at Lydia's house. And from Lydia's house, the church was started. Okay. From Lydia's house, the church was started. She was a businesswoman, and the church started out of her house. And I'm sure that the church met at her house. From this lady, the church at Thyatira started.
I know why y'all quiet, because y'all with the Southern Baptists and think that, you know, a lady can't be a minister. But guess what? If it started at her house, guess what? It started at her house, and she's a businesswoman, and she's used to running things. Guess what? Mm-hmm.
Lydia started this church in her house, in her hometown, in the town of Thyatira, and from that church, they began to preach and do good things and began to do good works within the city. Paul and Silas came there. They helped establish the church. But from that point onward, it was up to Lydia and her groups to continue the ministry of Jesus Christ. They had the real thing. All of them believed in Jesus Christ, that he lived, that he died, and he was buried, and he was resurrected. They had the real thing. But now, some 25 years later, we see Jesus writing, saying, these are the words of the Son of God, whose eyes are like blazing fire, and whose feet are like burnished bronze. The burning fire, the eyes like burning fire, means he sees everything. Not only the good stuff, but the bad stuff as well. When we're looking at these scriptures, don't just look at it as the church of Thyatira, but look at it at the church of St. John. Don't just look at it as the church of St. John, but look at it as it reflects on you and on me individually. Jesus says, I know your works. There's some good stuff that's happening there. He says, I know who you are. Your love and your faith, your service and perseverance. And now that you're doing even more than you did at first, there's goodness there. This church had a good reputation, and from all outside appearance, people in this church loved the Lord. People in this church had vibrant faith. People in this church did service in the community. People in this church did outreach beyond the walls of the church. And wherever they started, it seems like each and every year they did more and they did more. This is the only church within these seven churches that Jesus commended for their love. They loved folk. They loved each other. There wasn't any bickering or walking by folk, looking at people and acting like you didn't see them. There wasn't any stuff. I remember I came in church one time and had my mind on something, and I was walked by somebody, and they said, "Well, I didn't sleep with you last night." I was like, "What?" "You need to say hi to me." I was like, "You're right. You're right." And all of us need to love one another enough to at least say good morning. At least say, how you doing? Yeah. Please. You don't know what people have been going through during the week. Some people haven't seen anybody else throughout the week. Some people are just locked in their homes, and they come out to the house of God. They need to hear a word from you. Yeah. Yeah. Biggest whooping I got was walking past Miss Sally Lynch and didn't speak. I didn't know her. I didn't know her. I never forgot her. She called Grandma. Grandma's hands was coarse as wood. And I never forgot her. And every time, even I don't even have to know you. I don't have to, ever since then, I don't even have to know you to say good morning. How you doing? Hello. How you been? I don't have to know you, but I'm going to speak to you. We need to speak to each other. I hate that COVID came in, because every now and then we need a hug from one another. I hate that COVID came in, even if it's one of these church hugs. You know how y'all do the church hug. You know. But we need to lift one another up, because there's so many things that's happened throughout the week, and we need to be affirmed that we are somebody. But then Jesus looked and said, "I love what you're doing. But nevertheless, here's the bad. You tolerate that woman Jezebel, who calls herself a prophet. By her teaching, she misleads my servants into sexual immorality and to eating of food sacrificed to idols. I've given her time to repent of her immorality, but she is unwilling. So I will cast her on the bed of suffering, and I will make those who commit adultery with her suffer intensely, unless they repent of their ways." That's the bad. I don't know what was going on, but I know Jezebel wasn't there. But we're talking about the spirit of Jezebel. And Jezebel was a woman that married the king of Israel, and therefore she was the queen of Israel. And she was an evil queen, because she had people worshiping another god called Baal. And you remember the story. Elijah went up to the kingdom, and he went before the people and said, "How are we going to worship two people or two gods? If Baal is the god, worship him. If Yahweh is the God, worship him. And he said, what we're going to do is have a test. And whoever lights up the sacrifice with fire will be the God we'll worship. The government had 450 prophets that was with Baal and with Jezebel. And it was only one, Yahweh, Elijah. And all day long, they tried to get the fire to come and light the sacrifice. Then after a while and by, Elijah came and spoke a word, and the fire came down and lit the fire and lit the sacrifice. After which, Elijah killed those 450 false prophets. And Jezebel said, I'm coming after you. May the Lord do to me even more so if I don't kill you for what you did to my prophets. And Elijah ran. They said the king was trying to catch him in the chariot, but he outran the chariot. He ran 30 miles. He was outrunning the horse, scared to death. But the thing that was going on with Jezebel was that she was leading the people astray. And she did it because she was dealing with other gods, and there's always some heresies that's going on during the church, where every time the church is building up. When the church builds up, we start seeing other heresies that comes around to bring the church down. Everybody wants to know, why is it, or how is it that God allows this to happen? How is it and why is it that we find all these heresies coming toward the church? But I want to let you know something. And I'm going to be through here in a little bit. But Satan comes to church. He ain't at the club. He got those folks. He come to church to destroy the household of faith. Here this woman was in a church, and she called herself a prophet, and she was spewing all this stuff. Be careful. Who's prophesying over you? She was talking about all of this stuff. And don't you know Satan comes to church? And Satan, you never heard anybody sing like Satan can sing. Oh my God, he was in charge of worship in the kingdom of God. He can sing. Satan can preach. Satan can shout. Satan can do all of these things to fool people into thinking is that way. Good and bad and ugly. Because what we find is in the church house of faith, we're supposed to be influencing the world. Well, many times, the ugly part of it is the world influences us. So if you don't watch out, we'll be doing the stinky leg right here at church. There should be a difference between who we are as a church of God and who we are as we go about our daily business. There should be something about you, something about me that would let people say something's different about that person. We should be able to, when people come to the household of faith, they should hear a difference in the music. Oh, I wish I had somebody. But many times we find ourselves being influenced by the culture. And the next thing we know, we're saying what is right is wrong, and what is wrong is right. And if you don't mind, after a while and by, Jesus comes in and says, gives you the opportunity to repent of our sins. Repentance is for you, and repentance is for me. We can't just keep going on like everything is all right. Every now and then, we need to take a look and say, Lord, forgive me. Lord, help me. Lord, I'm sorry. Lord, I didn't mean it. Lord, direct me, lead me, guide me, show me your way. Many of us have been in church so long that we don't even go to God in prayer. We need him every day, every hour. Yeah, yeah. We need to see the Lord. Well, Jesus says, hold on to what you have. Ain't nothing like the real thing. Hold on to the real thing. The way you did and the way you understood when you first came into the household of faith, go back and find that way that you were. Do you remember how excited you were? And how proud you were to be in the household of faith. How this church used to make folk go around and say, well, I'm going to be baptized. And people, old folk, would say, well, you're going to have to change your ways. And people would say, yes, I'm going to change. And you're not going to see me doing the same things that I used to do. Sometimes we got to go back and hold on to the real stuff. Not this phony stuff that we have in today's culture. Well, brothers and sisters, I'm taking my seat. But I just wanted to let you know that there is nothing like the real thing. Amen. Amen.
Doors of the church are open. If there's any man, woman, boy, or girl who is here that doesn't know Jesus Christ and the pardon of their sins, we ask that they would come. Teaching. Lord, we ask that you bless each and every person that is here. We pray, Lord, that in all the things that we do and all the things that we can do, that we would be kind to one another. Continue to bless us, bless this branch of Zion. Continue to stand with us and keep us, Lord. We give your name the glory, the praise, and the honor. In the matchless and mighty name of Jesus Christ, we do pray. And now may God, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide in our hearts. Give us peace, love, and joy this day, henceforth, and forevermore. Let the church say, amen.